Lord be with you. So great to have a conversation going on. Such a wonderful thing. And it's so good to see all of you here. We especially welcome those who might be watching us online. And if you are a guest of the house, we especially want to make you feel welcome. So are there any visitors to the house on this day? Please. Where are you? What part of Pennsylvania are you from?
We're from
Maryland. Ah, okay. Well, good to have you here. And in the back? I know you too. From Maryland and Florida, respectively. Good to have you here. Anyone else? Well, so be it. We've got lots of things going on. Certainly life at LCOS is not the living as easy in July. The calendar is full as it should be. So a new grief share section will begin next Saturday, August the 3rd. In the morning, I think it's at 9:30. Barbara Mulvey is the contact person for that. This is a really incredibly helpful resource for people who are going through the very complicated and very personal journey that grief finally is. So if you want more information about Grief Share, go onto our website. You'll find the link there, and you can actually register through that link. But I really encourage you to consider coming and be part of that. It's like a 10-week series, I think. It goes until October, I think. If you're going through grief, I think you would find it very helpful. We also, obviously, we're on the cusp of Vacation Bible School for little people. We had the Vacation Bible School for not-so-little people back in June, in other words, for adults. But this time around, it's for the kids. And so we have a goodly crew who's part of the staff for that. And if you have questions or concerns about that, please see my wife, Marcia, who's kind of the default director, I guess, if I can say it that way. So we're excited. We're hoping that some more kids will come. If you know of any little people in your neighborhood who might benefit from having some time here, that's August the 5th through the 9th, 9 to 12 each morning. So please encourage them to come. Also, if you are of the female persuasion, the LWNL convention is coming up, and that is coming up in the deadline. Registration for that is August the 15th. So again, if you're on the female side of the thing here, you might want to take a look at the information about that convention and that gathering, which should be a very exciting time. If you have not yet picked up your pictorial directory, please do so. They are labeled. I'm only giving one per family because we don't have a lot of extras here. So if you have not picked up yours yet, please do so. If you have any questions about it, please see Ann Johns. That might be enough. I don't know. Probably enough. Oh, you were going to... No, that's it. Okay.
Yep.
Okay. And it's Jerry.
Thank you.
your eyes as we begin our praise to the gracious God. As always, we make our strong beginning in the name of God the Father, and of God the Son, and of God the Holy Spirit. And we join together in the opening prayer. Gracious God,
you have placed within the hearts of all your children a longing for your word and a hunger for your truth. Grant that we may know your Son to be the true bread of heaven and share this bread with all the world. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen.
Please remain standing for the singing of the Psalms.
Oh,
brothers and sisters in life, we face difficult choices. Let us pause to reflect on how we have often wrongly responded, and how God in his mercy has remained faithful. I invite you to take a moment of silence to reflect on how you've been living your life in these last several days. And let us confess. Father, you we live and move and have our being.
Look upon us, your children, the work of your hands. Forgive us all our offenses, and cleanse us from proud thoughts and empty desires. By your grace, draw us near to you, our refuge and our strength, through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Listen again to the words of Paul as he wrote to the first century church in Rome, and as he now speaks to us. Paul writes, "Since we are justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ. For God's love has been poured into our hearts through the Holy Spirit given to us. In the mercy of Almighty God, Christ died for us while we were still sinners, and for his sake, God forgives you all of your sin. Rejoice." You may be seated as we listen to the lessons. The lessons assigned to be read for this, the 10th Sunday in the ordinary time and season of the church. It goes back to the Old Testament and to the book of 2 Kings, which we don't often read from. It's a little snippet in the middle of a seeming long story, but understand that the reason for the choice of this lesson is actually kind of a setup for the gospel lesson. It's a way of reminding us that what happened in the New Testament also happened in the Old. This is, again, the prophet Elisha, who took the place of Elijah. It's, again, God provided when there was need. Good things for us to remember as well. 2 Kings 4, beginning at verse 42.
A man came from Baal Shalisha, bringing the man of God 20 loaves of barley bread, baked from the first ripe grain, along with some heads of new grain. "Give it to the people to eat," Elisha said. "How can I set this before 100 men?" his servant asked. But Elisha answered, "Give it to the people to eat, for this is what the Lord says. They will eat and have some left over." Then he set it before them, and they ate and had some left over, according to the word of the Lord. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The New Testament reading comes to us from the pen of St. Paul, as he writes to the first century church in Ephesus, but also into all of the churches in Laodicea and Asia Minor. It is Paul trying to present a vision, if you will, a blueprint of what a Christian church should look like. And we in the lectionary series are actually working our way through the whole letter to the Ephesians. And so this is the focus for the sermon today, not the gospel lesson. So please listen carefully, and I hope you'll be edified as you do. It's rich in imagery, it's powerful in thought. It is Paul as some of his best, trying to help first century Christians recognize the power and the enormity of grace. These are good words for us to hear as well. Ephesians 3, beginning at verse 14.
"For this reason, I kneel before the Father, from whom every family in heaven and on earth derives its name. I pray that out of his glorious riches, he may strengthen you with power through his Spirit in your inner being, so that Christ may dwell in your hearts through faith. And I pray that you, being rooted and established in love, may have power, together with all the Lord's holy people, to grasp how wide and long and high and deep is the love of Christ, and to know this love that surpasses knowledge, the that you may be filled to the measure of all the fullness of God. Now to him who is able to do immeasurably more than all we ask or imagine, according to his power that is at work within us. To him be glory in the church and in Christ Jesus throughout all generations, forever and ever. Amen. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The word of the Holy Gospel is given to us from the witness of St. John, the 6th chapter beginning at the 1st verse. Sometime after this, Jesus crossed to the far shore of the Sea of Galilee, that is the Sea of Tiberias, and a great crowd of people followed him because they saw the signs he had performed by healing the sick. Jesus went up on a mountainside and sat down with his disciples. The Jewish Passover festival was near, and when Jesus looked up and saw a great crowd coming toward him, he said to his disciple Philip, "Where shall we buy bread for all these people to eat?" He asked this only to test Philip, for Jesus already had it in his mind what he was going to do. Philip answered him, "It would take more than half a year's wages to buy enough bread for each one just to have a bite." But another of his disciples, Andrew, Simon's Peter brother, spoke up. "Here is a boy with 5 small barley loaves and 2 small fish. But how far will that go among so many?" Jesus said, "Have the people sit down." There was plenty of grass in that place, and they sat down. About 5,000 men were there. Jesus then took the loaves, gave thanks, and distributed to those who were seated as much as they wanted. Did the same with the fish. And when they had had all enough to eat, he said to his disciples, "Gather the pieces that are left over. Let nothing be wasted." So they gathered them and filled 12 baskets with the pieces of the 5 barley loaves was left over by those who had eaten. And after the people saw the sign Jesus performed, they began to say, "Surely this is the prophet who is to come into the world." Jesus, knowing that they intended to come and make him king by force, withdrew again to a mountain by himself. When evening came, his disciples went down to the lake, where they got into a boat and set off across the lake for Capernaum. By now it was dark. Jesus had not yet joined them. A strong wind was blowing, the waters were rough, and when they had rowed about 3 or 4 miles, they saw Jesus approaching the boat, walking on the water, and they were frightened. He said to them, "It is I. Don't be afraid." They were willing to take him into the boat, and immediately the boat reached the shore where they were heading. This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
With heart and voice, we confess our faith in Christ in the words of the creedal statement. I believe
in one God, united in one heart, ruler of heaven and earth, full of grace and mercy. I believe in the Father, who has created me and all that exists. I believe in the Son,
seated for the singing of the song.
Mm-hmm.
God's grace, God's mercy, and God's kind of peace. Press deep in your minds and your hearts this day and always because of our Lord Jesus Christ. And as I mentioned, the text is from that Ephesian lesson we just read a few moments ago, and especially the one verse, the God who is able to do immeasurably more than we could ask or imagine. So for the text, the narthex, or the lobby of the church, is the entry point. It's the first thing that people see when they come through the doors. And typically found in a narthex, or lobby of a church, are maybe some artwork to inspire, probably some brochures to read, and always, of course, as a sign of hospitality, a place to sit. Well, our narthex has all of those things with the curious addition of a very old green chair in a wooden box that is on the wall. The quick story is that that very chair and others like it were the chairs that the first people of LCOS used when they began holding worship services here in July of 1950. During the week, those chairs sat in the rafters of Mike and Eleanor Kardash's house, their garage, actually. And when the congregation found out what place they were going to be able to rent to actually hold worship that weekend, chairs were dutifully taken out, set up, worship accomplished on Sunday morning, and Sunday night, the chairs went back into the rafters of the Kardash's garage. This went on week after week, month after month, year after year. From July of 1950 until the mid-1980s, which is when the congregation bought and built this building. For more than 30 years, a very small group of people in what was then a very small town called Rehoboth, where nothing was going on, literally between Labor Day and Memorial Day. One of them told me, "Pastor, you could go bowling on Route 1 after Labor Day is over." Can you imagine such a thing today? But they underwent several challenges, all kinds of descriptions, but they were persistent. They just simply were willing to trust and believe that God had something in mind for this place, and that a congregation that would exhibit or reflect the grace of God in Christ was needed here. All of those charter members are gone. While they were still here, they delighted in seeing how the church grew and how it became a viable presence in this community and how it continued to reach out, touching many, many lives with compassionate grace. They were so glad to see what it had become. They died with, I hope, satisfied hearts. But every person who sits in these pews today is called in the same way in their baptism to go and tell, not sit and stay. That's a good thing to keep in mind, that all of us are grappling with this avalanche of people who are moving to this area, filling up all of these houses that are popping up like mushrooms overnight. All of those people are coming from different places. They all have different stories. They've all had their own life script. They've all had lots of joys, lots of sorrows. They're as different as they could be, but they have one thing in common. Every one of them needs to know the love that God has for them in Christ. So how could this congregation continue to be a sign of that presence and grace? How could this congregation be as bold today and in the future as it was in the past in incarnating Christ's love? Along the way, those people who first started this church learned the power of Paul's words that God can do immeasurably more than we could ask or imagine. Right now, your calendar is rich and full, and I'm proud of that. I'm glad of that. It is so good to see. Because most of what you do is focused out there, not only taking care of in here. You're living out the mission Jesus intended. But what's next? What other possible ways in the future moment of this congregation could you find to engage people with the love of God in Christ? How might you again serve them in ways that might draw them close to the love that God has for them? But even more, how about you as an individual? Let's make it personal here. How might God continue to unfold ways in which your words and actions might be a sign of grace and compassionate hope to a world in desperate need of both? How could God be at work in you, encouraging you to new things? What might be the immeasurably more that God could do with you and for you? God is not done with LCOS. God is not done with you. And yes, I realize, of course, that many of you are retired, which is a Latin word meaning I spend more time with my doctors. I also know that many of you probably are thinking the days of immeasurably more are not there for me anymore. I can barely get out of bed, and I need a walker to get anywhere. It is hard to feel optimistic when you deal with stuff every day. The willingness to believe in the possibility that God is not done with you yet is admittedly a stretch. Because while we worship the God of surprise, we also live in a world of surprise. And oftentimes those surprises dull our spirit and take away our joy. I can't think of a single amusement park in all of America that doesn't have at least one roller coaster ride. And many amusement parks have several different roller coaster rides. And my own thought about why that's such a popular kind of ride is because it mimics life in a very profound way. You get on a roller coaster, and suddenly you're going up high, and then in a second you're going down low at incredible speed. It is very exciting, it is scary as heck, and you're not in control of any of it. And when life feels like you're on some kind of runaway roller coaster ride, well, it's hard to find the courage to believe that God could be doing immeasurably more. The moments when we feel like everything's cut loose, congregations sort of retreat to what has been. Let's just keep it as it has always been here. 8 o'clock, 10:30, Jerry sings, it's all good. And maybe as an individual, you begin to feel too that, let's just keep my life in the safe routine. Because we learned along the way that if we don't take any risks, there's no chance of surprise. I'm sure the people in Ephesus to whom Paul was writing originally also had that sense of hesitance. Because living in first century Rome, they also were greeted with lots of surprises daily, none of which were good. You could be killed for being a Christian, you know. And they didn't see a whole lot of promise in the future, at least not on this side. Maybe that's why Paul writes these powerful words in our text. They are so deep and rich with imagery, trying to help them to understand just the enormity of the gospel itself, of what it means when we say, God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whoever believes me, not perish but have everlasting life. There is strength in holding on to that. There is power enough in there to overcome any lingering despair and any darkening doubt. Can you think of a time in your own life when you as an individual or as a member of this congregation experienced a time when there was more darkness than light? Can you think of a time in your life as a person or in this congregation where things were driven by fear and anxiety and no direction? Can you think of a time when your faith in Christ helped you to get through those moments and you begin to reclaim hope? Can you think of a time when you finally were in a dark enough place that you finally turned around and began to look at things through the cross and suddenly began to see things in a very different way? I can only hope that you've had those kind of moments of revelation. I know that I have, and I still do. And each time I get turned around, each time that I go back to the cross, the love of God in Christ becomes even bigger than it was before. Because the gospel remains the ultimate surprise. The God loving us in spite of foolish decisions and bad choices. Of the gospel is that that love God has for us never has, nor will it ever change. It's a done deal. That's what the cross is about. When Pastor Bill Harmon was elected as our bishop almost 3 years ago, he, like all before him, chose a theme verse that he would use during all of his years serving in office. He chose this verse from Ephesians as his theme verse. To God, who is able to do immeasurably more than we could ask or imagine. Because he wanted pastors, he wanted congregations, he wanted lay people to begin to think again, hopefully. He realized, in spite of this very different landscape that we as church are now living in America, God is still at work. Next July, Bishop Harmon will be here. Because next July, you're going to celebrate the 75th year of your ministry in this community. And he's coming to be part of the party. And when he comes, I hope to God that you will show him that green chair in the wooden case on the wall and tell him the story. I know Bishop Harmon well enough to know that he will smile. He will like that. And while you're at it, the next time you're in the narthex, spend a few moments looking at that green chair and realize again that God is still at work in this congregation and also in your own life. Even in ways you cannot begin to understand, doing immeasurably more than you could ever ask or imagine. And may that give your faith new energy and your life unbounded joy. Let the people of God say, Amen. Amen. Thank you. first century until now, and yet continuing, part of Christian worship has always been a time for prayer, a time for taking Jesus at his word that where two or three gather, he is in the midst of them. And again, to reaffirm that we believe God listens, and God's way and time, God answers. So on this day, we're praying for lots of people. We're praying for lots of people who are recovering. For Jennifer Cornell, Pete and Carol's daughter. For Chris Price, who spent all week in Beebe and is now home. Janet Wazawillo, who spent time at Beebe but now is in Pennsylvania with her daughter for the week. For Anita Funk, who came through foot surgery. Gail Froelich, who came through back surgery. For Donald Leister, Marilyn Davis's brother, also came through back surgery. For Phyllis Parker, who I was able to see this week, who was at home, doing well, doing much better than she was before. We also pray for those who are going through treatment or tests. We pray especially for Judy Steinman, yet going through chemotherapy for breast cancer. For Kathy Holster, going through a treatment for cancer. For Louise Dassler, recovering from heart surgery. And for Peter Smith, son of George and Paul, who is going through tests and diagnostic procedures. We also join with those who mourn. We pray for the family of Clara Weber. This is Fred's sister, for whom we have prayed before. Clara died on Friday. And we also celebrate with those who are marking milestones in their life. For Ryder Gruber, Shirley Flegel, Chip Lytle, Gloria Zaccardi, Jeannie Johansson, William Lockman, Florence Kruer, Jane McCleary, Maggie Arnberg, Christine Mignon. This was evidently a popular week to be born, at least among our faith family. Anniversaries, John and Liz Dean, Chuck and Diane Leofield, and Ricky and Donna Frederick. So for these and others, we pray. I invite you to rise if you're able. God of grace and mercy, with joy and thanksgiving, we open our eyes to the gift of a new day. We pray that as we continue to move through this day, that we are pulled in one direction or another, listening to one voice or another, that you would keep our mind and heart centered again on the gospel hope. May we realize and trust and excitedly believe that you are and can do immeasurably more with us and through us than we could possibly ask or imagine. Help us to live lives with humility, with grace, and with joyful heart. Lord, in your mercy.
Amen.
We pray, God, for the world beyond these doors, especially places where there is conflict and where there is restlessness and where there is anger. We pray, O God, that somehow you, as the author of peace, would find a way to break down behind the stubborn hearts and wills of people. It should help us realize what again it means to live on a very small planet. Help us to learn again to listen and to love. Lord, in your mercy.
Amen.
We pray for this country in which we live and which we love. We pray, God, that you would give us a double measure of patience and humor and grace to listen more than speak and to try to understand more than to judge. Help us to learn to be patient with each other, to find ways of working with each other so that together we might work for the common good. Lord, in your mercy.
Amen.
We pray for the church throughout the world that it might be persistent in its witness, that it might continue to believe that you are and can do immeasurably more through us and through the word and the sacrament and the fellowship of your people gathered. Help us, Lord, to live with this anticipation and hope. Lord, in your mercy. We pray for this congregation. We pray that each member might be stronger in faith than when they came in. We pray, O God, that you would give them grace to live out in the world as your hands, as your feet, and to realize again they have still much to offer. Lord, in your mercy. We pray, O God, for many people in our minds and on our hearts. We pray especially this day for Jennifer,
Chris,
Janet,
Jen.
Anita.
Gail.
Donald. Phyllis. Judy. Kathy. Louise.
Louise.
Peter.
Peter.
In whatever place they are in today, O Lord, come near to them. May they know that you are present as you have promised to be. And may they know that your love for them is great. Give them the peace which the world cannot give, Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
We pray, God, also for those who mourn. We pray especially for the family of Clara. May you give them the certainty and conviction of the resurrection, hope, and promise, Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
We pray, God, for those who are marking milestones in their life. We pray for Reiner. Shirley. Chip. Gloria. Jeannie. William. Florence. Jane. Maggie. Christine. John and Liz. Chuck and Diane. Ricky and Donna. Whatever the milestone is, O God, may you give them grace that they look back to examine what has been. Help them to realize that your love has seen them through a lot. And may that give them courage and grace enough as they look to what yet might be. Help them to trust that you are part of the journey with them, Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
Be with us, O Lord, as we come again to table again, taking you at your word, the promise that you gave to us over 20 centuries ago, this profound mystery of bread and wine and body and blood that we can scarcely begin to understand. And you make us bold in believing that as we participate, as you call us to, that you will find us here, and that you again will be present in our life, offering us the assurance of forgiveness and hope, Lord, in your mercy. Into your hands, O God, we commend ourselves and all for whom we pray, trusting in your mercy, through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen.
And we join together as we say,
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever.
The peace of the Lord be with you now and always. We share that peace enthusiastically with each other.
Thank you.
In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread. When he had given thanks, he broke it, and he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat, this is my body, which is given for you. This do in remembrance of me." In the same way also he took a cup of the wine. When he had given thanks, he gave that to them, saying, "Take and drink of this, all of you. This cup is the New Testament in my blood. It is shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." The peace of the Lord be with you always. Please be seated. This is the body of Christ given for you. Take and eat. That body of Christ given for you. Take and eat. Body of Christ given for you. Take and eat. Jeannie, the body of Christ given for you. Take and eat. Ron, this is the body of Christ given for you. Take and eat. Jerry, the body of Christ given for you. Take and eat. The brother, this is the body of Christ given for you. Take and eat. Bread, the body of Christ given for you, take and eat. And this is the body of Christ given for you, take and eat. And may it be the body and blood of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, evermore strengthen and preserve you in faith until your life everlasting. Depart in his peace and for his service. Amen. That this is the body of Christ given for you. Take and eat. John, this is the body of Christ given for you.
Christ, we find thee, 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 Christ, we find thee,
body of Christ will be given. It's the body of Christ that is given for giving.
Thank you.
be the body and blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ evermore, strengthen and preserve you in faith until your life everlasting. Depart in his service and in his peace. Amen.
Amen.
I invite you to rise. Again, the Latin word benediction means to speak well. Benedictus. So this is God speaking well to you. May the blessing of God Almighty, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit be in abide with you now and always.
Amen.
Amen.
One, two, three, four.
Yes, sir.